partying bullshit. All I wanna do. This party is too lit.
Starting out, and she was on 16 or better. I brought some spitters around, man. So you've been putting people on, Jack.
A long time,
Sir. Yes, sir.
And with your support, man, you know, making me official and whatnot, and you know, letting people know that, hey, the legends in the game respect what I'm doing, and it helped validate what I was trying to do to push the agenda. I really, really appreciate you for that.
All right, and I appreciate you always calling me out, man.
My man.
Got a lot for you, Jack.
Ladies got a lot of questions for you, man. Hey, shit, fire away.
All right, let's hop right into it. You're wearing the shirt. What do you got going on with Ill Town Sluggers? Am I saying it right?
Yeah, Ill Town Sluggers.
Tell us about that.
That's a new venture our DJ and producer KG and I have. Slugger Music, Slugger Ventures. We signed the girl Leah Janae from The Four on Fox last season. Y'all know her?
Yeah, congrats.
Leah, so we got her going, joint venture with Cinematic Music Group. She just shot her second video, and she'll be out there all summer. Oh, and she just finished touring with Marsha Ambrosius from Orange.
Big fan.
Okay, you're putting people in a position to win.
Yeah, definitely.
So what's up with this Silk City? In the strip club? Okay, you in the strip club?
Yeah.
Well, he got caught just now. He was like,
She knows. My girlfriend is a bartender, so she bartends at strip clubs. But one of them is Soap City. And every year, like, I do have a crew of girls like this. They call them Naughty Shorties. And Shorty parties in the strip club. So I'd have every dancer, every bartender, even all the guys just draped out in naughty gear. But that's something that I hold to the side until I settle in Vegas. But my girlfriend, every year, I let her do a birthday party with it. So whatever club it is, we flip it. So
it looks
her
hot.
Club was Soap City, so I did Soap City by nature.
Yeah, ooh. I was like, yeah, that looks like something you could expand on, take it to different cities.
Oh, yeah, I can... Hugh Hefner passed away, so God rest his soul with Playboy. So I own the trademark on the word naughty. So you
the word naughty belongs to you.
Wow. Yeah, naughty by nature. Naughty by nature. So we can flip naughty any way we want.
Yeah.
Speaking of owning your own, I'm sure you read or heard De La Soul. Their music is going to be now streaming on different platforms, but they're only going to be receiving 10%. I think that's crazy for all that they have done for the culture and in, you know, hip hop history. Have you ever run into any things like that where you're not able to get what you feel like you're owed?
Nah, we were blessed that when we first came out, we got signed in 1990 by Queen Latifah and Shaquem from Flavor Unit.
Hey.
And as a matter of fact, that same label, Tommy Boy Records, Queen Latifah, us, and De La Soul were signed to the same label. So I'm not sure what their business was with Tommy Boy Records, but with Flavor Unit, Queen Latifah, and us, we had great deals, so we never had those problems. Until this day, we still have great rapport with Tommy Boy Records.
Right. Would you say, what would you say to an artist that's going on now that doesn't know the business side of the music, but like to avoid all of that?
Well, I think there's enough information out there right now, and there's been so many artists getting screwed that if you go into this game blindly and just sign anything, then you probably deserve to get
you
fucked.
Definitely.
You know what I mean? So there's enough information out there. There's enough attorneys and tons of consultants out there where you don't have to go out there and make these crazy deals. You know what I mean? So just take your time, do your research, and do the business first, because it is the music business.
Hey, so with that being said too, man, you know, I hate to hear people say they screwed me over and da da da. Yo, you're the one signed that shit. You wanted to be on so fucking bad.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You did that. Nobody did that. I hate them stories. I hate them.
Well, I think what you have to realize is that when you go into anyone and they're going to put you on, they invest in you. So other than that, you wouldn't be in their offices trying to get signed. So if you had the money, if you had all the answers, then you wouldn't need them. You would put up your money and show what you know. Mm-hmm. But since you do need these people to finance you and use their staff and team to market you, of course you're not going to get the best deal initially. You just make sure you don't sign a super long-term deal. But an album or two, maybe even three, hey, they have to put up money and they have to recoup their investment. So once they recoup their investment, you can always renegotiate. And that's the key word, renegotiate. And you should always be able to reset any relationship you're in.
Leah Janae, the artist that you're doing right now.
Yeah.
Like, you know, not to get into her business, but in this climate, how would you go about setting up a situation to put an artist on inside of a real independent climate?
Yeah, well, I mean, we're teaching, because we were so blessed. We had Queen Latifah, we grew up with her. She got put on before us, and Queen was so unselfish in that everything she learned about the business, we learned about the business, which when we signed to them, we learned so much that when we weren't signed to them, we were able to continue to do business. We do business, you know, till this day. So we're going to set, and we are setting up Leah Janae just like that, to be self-empowered, that we have a relationship now. When and if she grows to a point where she feels she doesn't need us anymore, then we're like, fly, baby girl, fly. There's a ton of artists out here. You know what I'm saying? So you don't have to lock anyone down forever. You don't have to be in their pockets forever. It could be a temporary situation, but you can still do business long term.
Yeah. So mentorship is important.
Absolutely, absolutely. You need that knowledge, you know, because it's tough out here.
Nice. You don't know what you don't know.
Hey, so I'm Harmony. Hi.
Hi, Harmony.
So quick thing about artists and coming to these labels, especially independent. You know, back in the days, they used to do artist development. They don't do artist development anymore. Is your label offering that for an artist that's you see has either a great potential, some talent? Is your label offering that, or you just want them that already have their followers and already have their stuff ready to go?
No, our guy KG, you know, KG is one third of Naughty by Nature as well. He's the DJ and producer. So KG put out Next, Jhené, Jaheim, and he loves artist development. So K doesn't really like artists coming so polished. He likes artists who he sees the potential in, and he loves to take them and mold them. So even before Leah did the four, K had her in the studio a year prior to that. So the EP she has out now, Leah Meets Nina Simone, you know, that project was almost finished before the four even aired. So what we have going on is we released that EP, and that was just going to be a mixtape. He just wanted to get, you know, the water wet with her and take an iconic musician like Nina Simone and sample Nina Simone and make music with Leah. Now they're working on her first real world project. Although the Nina project is crazy hot, so make sure y'all check that out on all streaming platforms. Leah Meets Nina.
When you're looking to sign new artists, what specifically do you look for?
Now, for me, I look for more self-contained artists because, again, when we approached Queen Latifah, we weren't Naughty by Nature. We were a group called The New Style. So we were a local group. We were self-financed. We had all of our own apparel and everything. So by the time we found Queen Latifah, all we did is say, meet us at this gymnasium. It was a basketball gym, and we filled it up. And we were like 17, 18 years old at the time. And we showed them everything we did, our following, gave them the demo, and they were like that, and they signed us up. So for me, you know, I definitely like the fact that Kay loves to develop artists musically, but for me, I like artists who come to the table with some sort of movement already. Because people come and say, hey, I'm hot, or hey, I'm ready. But, you know, if you can't get your own backyard fired up, then you need to do more work.
That's right.
I had a question in reference to something you were doing. My name's Vanessa, by the way.
Hi.
Something you were doing way back, I guess, in reference to battle rapping. Mm-hmm. What happened to that? Because I seen that it changed from when you started it to now.
Oh, yeah. Well, the UW Network. Yeah. Well, what happened, mutual friends of mine brought me to the UW people at the time because they wanted help with figuring out what they were doing with their battles. And what I saw is that I wasn't a super fan of the, you know, rap battle community.
Any particular reason why?
Well, I mean, I'm busy doing what I do, but I'm into technology. So what I learned about the rap battle community is that they were having these events and they were loading all of their content to YouTube. And with YouTube, they were getting paid out, but paid out pennies on a dollar. Mm-hmm. So when I saw the scope of the rap battle thing, I was like, you know what? Y'all need to go pay-per-view. Mm-hmm. So that's when I came in and figured out, let's use Ustream, charge $30 a head for pay-per-view. We had a camera crew set up and able to do live streaming, and we banged it out and made a lot of money, you know? And then I think the two parties, they began to fall out and go their different ways. So I was like, all
right. Are you still making apps? Because it seemed like when in the interview that I listened to, like you actually make apps? Or is that...
Oh, I have a team who does that, yeah. Oh. They're up in
Toronto. Are you working on anything right now?
Well, actually, yes. Our online shop at naughtybynature.com, naughtybynaturestore.com, you know, all of this stuff, we started that in like 94, but now because of social media, we're making like 10 times more money than we were then, and now our brand is reaching so much broader now, without any drama, you know? I know the younger people, it's like, you're not popping unless you got drama going on up here. Yeah. Soulja Boy calling cats out, who wants smoke? I'm just waking up today. Who wants smoke, you know? But we're more in a corporate world now. As a matter of fact, we have a collaboration coming up with Major League Baseball. So, oh, Jack, you know, all of those different configurations, it would be Yankee by Nature, Mets by Nature, the Dodgers by Nature, and that thing is unheard of. So it's big corporate, clean business.
Is that where Sluggers comes into play?
Oh, no. Sluggers is a whole nother bag.
Tell them about that bag. Yeah. I know you're retired now. Tell them about the Slugger bag.
Yeah, I wanna know the mix behind the Slug.
Oh, the Slugger. Well, that's our music company, and Lee and Janae is our first artist under them. So there'll be more music and stuff coming out with that. You know, we're taking care of her. She's on tour, and even us, we'll be out there with Salt and Pepper, New Kids on the Block, hey, about to knock out like 57 arenas all over this country.
Yeah.
That's
the arena.
Yeah. Congratulations. Thank you.
You're welcome.
But again, that's more of our business these days. It's clean, it's quiet, it's corporate, and we don't have any drama. And that story, I love it. You know what I'm saying?
Respect. So being in the industry for so long,
how
do you keep yourself relevant?
I just stay busy, stay true to ourselves. Like one of the other guests said, I'm not, you know, chasing what other people are doing. And I know a lot of my peers, some peers don't do the business we do. Some peers do a little more business than us. But what comes attached to that is drama. So relevance to me is staying drama free. A lot of people, if you're not on our radar, then you're not on our radar. But in order to get me to be on your radar, if I got a coon and buffoon, I don't want to be a part of that business.
That's right.
At all.
Right, and you sound so comfortable and so passionate about everything you're doing. I don't even doubt you for a second. Like, this is it. This is your zone. And I feel like some people forget that so much happens behind the scenes. And yeah. I think that's where the real work happens versus in front of the camera.
Well, it's both. It's just that it's unfortunate today that drama drives everything. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? There's tons of artists, there's tons of people out here doing clean, quiet, profitable, lucrative business. They're just not dealing with all the drama. You know what I'm saying? So I just warn a lot of young people out here, you can get that quick look, but as you see, and then we have tons of examples, it's a short run, you know? We're celebrating our 28th year in the game this year. Yay. Next year will be 29 okay. years in the game. I'm 48 years old, you know? Wow. I'll be 49 this September. So the thing is, like, you got to stay out of drama, man, because, you know, it's treacherous out here. It's dangerous out here. Yeah. And as much as people can show you love, they can show you that devil side, too.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
And when you go out here, you got to realize, man, your life is in these other people's hands. And it doesn't matter who you are, you're not untouchable. So you definitely have to walk a humble path out here and just respect yourself and respect others. They'll take you up out of here quick.
You got to help people not kill you.
That's yeah. right. That's right.
Talk to them, Jack.
Hey, home. You got a chance to meet Michael Jackson.
Yes, sir.
You was in video with Michael Jackson, man.
Yeah.
I'm the biggest Michael Jackson fan ever in life. So I say.
Hence the Thriller.
Yeah, hence the Thriller. Yo, so let me ask you, was you starstruck?
Of course, you have to be starstruck with Mike in the building, man. We met Mike on the set of Jam. It was the Space Jam movie.
Yes,
and
yes.
he was shooting a video for it. And rest in peace, our big brother Heavy D, our manager Shaquem at the time, who's Queen Latifah's manager, was friends with Heavy D. So Heavy was actually on the song. And Shaquem had a Naughty by Nature jacket on, and Mike walked up to him like, hey, I like those guys. Because we sampled OPP, which was a Michael Jackson song. So Shaquem was like, yeah, I managed them. So I could get them here on the set if you want. Oh, that'd be great. So Mike flew us out to Chicago, and we did cameos in the video. But back then, they were moving so fast, it was a, who wasn't that? You know, you look at a video and be like, who wasn't that? So-and-so, who wasn't that? So it was quick, but we definitely got to take the pictures with them.
And did you go home, back to your hood, what are your people saying?
Oh, they was, shit, they were just super impressed, you know? Super impressed. We always bring it back to the home squad.
When Shaquem told you that it was going down and Michael Jackson wanted to meet you, like, or do you believe him?
What's going through your head? No, we were pretty hot back then, so we understood. You know what I mean?
We understood. So y'all were feeling yourself at that particular time in your career. You knew everything that was going on. You believed it. You owned it. You embraced it, and you knew you deserved it.
Well, the thing was this. It's like, it's similar to Nipsey Hussle, you know. We from our neighborhood. He started from Jersey. It's only 4 square miles, 70,000 people. Ever since we were the new style, we always had the support of our hometown, you know, from high school and all the way up until we switched to Naughty by Nature. So, you know, we did the same thing Nipsey did. We had a Naughty Gear store. We put up in 94 through, like, 99 downtown North, right in the middle of the hood. And, you know, it was that same vibe. The community came out, the community supported us. So, you know, to see what happened to Nipsey Hussle is unfortunate. But what I tell the young people is, don't fall for that narrative that if you come up, leave the hood and don't reinvest in the hood because they're going to kill you. Because everyone has their different, you know, encounters or their different relationships with their community. So, you know, the brother right here can attest to you that East Orange, Newark, our whole Jersey area, we get nothing but love around the way. You know what I'm saying? So we stay around the way. We still look for talent from around the way. We invest around the way. You know, we helped put our mayor in office around the way. So if anything, we need to keep doing more of what Nipsey did. Because if you don't change your hood, that's all that's going to be there. Or they're going to gentrify it and relocate you to another area, and the same shit will be going on. So I think right now a lot of people are enlightened. A lot of people are more woke and meaning conscious of what's going on. So at some point, all of this knowledge is going to sink in, and people are going to start acting different. Yeah. It may take a little while for them to act different, but right now the programming is happening. Just like we were programmed for destruction, we're programmed to rebuild.
Let me ask you, how was it being in a super group? Like, to me, like working with others, especially in these groups, a lot of times you find artists that split up and they don't stay together. How did you guys keep a positive rapport with one another, understanding what the business was, and still being successful instead of breaking apart, being independent, you know, artists?
Well, we've done that. We've fought physically. We've fought intellectually. We disbanded for a while. But we're so blessed that our brand is stronger than the bullshit. I always say the brand is bigger than the bullshit. Yeah. So you get to a point where people are trying to pull you away and say, ah, Trax, you should have been gone solo. Okay, you can do this and that. And we've done all of that. At the end of the day, people are trying to pull you apart just so your brand could fail. Yeah. And then you're sitting home with them doing nothing.
They're tricking you.
So we participated in all that. But at the end of the day, our brand was bigger than the bullshit, which always brings us back to the table. And like I said, 28, almost 29 years later, we're still out here doing 57 arenas. No one's moving like that. We're able to do business with Major League Baseball. No one's moving like that. And we're just going to continue to do big, corporate, quiet business.
So I love the 90s era. It is one of my biggest like things. I wish we could do things like we did back then, but we can't because we're new. But groupie stories. Now, I know the girls back then, crazy.
So tell us
a crazy groupie story.
Well, first of all, my big brother Mike Tyson said, never incriminate yourself.
I was going to ask you to do an impression of him.
But, I remember one time, right?
There it is.
So we were in Detroit, and I had this chick. She was a cop.
A little
freak, too. She was a freak.
So
she had a friend, and they came over to our hotel room, and I put Trex on her girl. So we had two separate rooms. It was a suite or whatever. And I had Trex in there, and the girl's going, This chick put ice in her mouth and went to work on me. I was in the room screaming. Trex came in there like, yo, what's going on in here? What are you doing screaming?
Go far, freak.
Oh.
Ice in the booty, huh? That's what booty. Ice in the booty
on
ice.
On my balls.
Oh my.
Oh.
See, my brain.
No, I'm not letting
that. Oh, that drip.
And eye contact.
You know, you're not asking because you like that, right? You
just came because you like that. Oh, yeah. Well, I'm sensitive. I'm
so sensitive. Wait, you say you have that all bent your ass?
Well, pray it back.
Nah.
Oh, okay. Because Jack said he does.
Oh, well, Jack does. I mean, to each his own. I'm just telling you how I roll.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Dope, man. Hey, so why the name change from the new style?
New style to Naughty by Nature. Yeah. Because we were getting away. We were signed to Sugar Hill Records back then.
I get it now.
Yeah, and that was a nightmare. So when we signed with Flavor Unit, Queen Latifah and them, they were like, first thing you're going to need to do is change your name to get away from this old contract. Mm. So we did that, and we started flipping through, you know, trying to find new names. And Trex went in his lyric book, and Naughty by Nature was actually the title of a new style song.
Mm.
So it was a song we had called Naughty by Nature as the new style, and Trex was like, look, everyone's a little naughty by nature, and that's when we took that name.
Okay.
And he was right, right?
You have such an amazing positive message, and you were saying you'd like to do clean, quiet, lucrative business. Why not be louder about that? Could you see yourself doing reality TV maybe to just get that positive message out there?
No, I would never do reality TV in the space that you see it in now. Like, I think even our girls, Salt and Pepper, they have a reality show coming out right now with WeTV.
Yeah.
And my personal opinion is that it did the girls no good because they don't need that exposure. It's not going to help increase their touring or anything. And as a matter of fact, it caused a bit of drama between the group in real life. Mm-hmm. See what I'm saying? In real life. So, like I said.
But it helped SWV though.
Well,
SWV, maybe it did on arrival.
And but that's not the truth because SWV, they work all year round. And that's what you guys got to understand. Just because you don't see them on the headlines and in the blogs and fighting each other and doing all this madness doesn't mean that they're not working and making millions. That's
I did that. You're exactly right. But when I was on, I think it was an interview about the reality show. They said the reality show actually helped them resurge and get back together and start getting booked.
Well, but you know, prior to the show they're on now, they did a show where it was just them, and it caused friction in their group. So they had to reset, and I don't know why they went back in, but. I don't need that business. And
I
believe there's other ways to make it louder, but unfortunately the media picks up on drama.
Yeah.
Like, yo, I on my mayor's transition team, raised thousands of dollars for him, do all kinds of stuff in the community, but if I slap the shit out of somebody, then I get all the free press on earth.
And he'd be like, oh man, I thought he was so positive, and what the hell is he doing?
You know what I'm saying? So that's just the way the media works. So I'm not worried about that. You see, if you follow our ecosystem, you see we moving out here. Heavy, heavy, heavy.
And then let's talk about this, the clothing line. Like merchandising. You was coming out, even with New Style, y'all had y'all own brand.
Right.
And you knew to do that. Where did this business model come from?
Well, we're 80s babies. So back in the 80s, you know, we had the Shirt Kings and Dapper Dan. So everyone was branded up. You would go and get your graffiti shirts done. So back then it was posses and you was rolling. So everybody had to come into place looking uniform. And that's how we grew up in the 80s. So when we had our crews, we were always branded out and laced up. And we were street kids too, so we used to hustle, but that just carried with us, you know what I'm saying? So once we started doing the music thing, it just carried with us, and we always had money, so we were always able to do what others can't.
Hey, one of my favorite possessions I own is the Gucci, I'm sorry, not the Gucci slide. I'm sorry, the Naughty by Nature slides you gave me for Christmas.
Yeah.
You gave me two pair.
Oh yeah?
Yeah, you gave me two pair of those, and I still wear them all the time, and I'm very inspired, and I want to get some party and bullshit slides and start doing Jackie's Angel slides and all that.
That's right.
Can you teach me the game, bro?
I can plug you in whatever you need.
Teach me the motherfucking game, bro.
That's right. Whatever you need, Jack, you know I got you, bro.
My man. Put me on Bonita Apple Bump. Right. You hear me? I'm ready.
Absolutely.
Word. Hey, two more questions, y'all. All
right. So one thing, like I said, I love the 90s. What's the one thing you wish can come back or be reinvented?
The only thing I wish is that we just stop the killing in hip hop right now. You know what I'm saying? I think everything is cool. I think all of the young people, for one, I think music is supposed to evolve. I don't want hip-hop sounding the way it did in the 70s, the way it did in the 80s, 90s, 2000s. I love the fact that you have these different eras, and you could be any age. You can go back and love 90s hip-hop. Someone may love 2000s hip-hop. Someone may love all of the new little turn-up drip, whatever they call it today. You know what I'm saying? But I think music should diversify, it should evolve, and it should be a fusion of everything. What we need to do is we gotta stop this killing out here because it's just not right, it's not healthy, and we have people all over the world enjoying our culture, and they get to take it, but they don't have to suffer like us, you know? And it's really, it makes me envious. It makes me jealous. Like, how can we be so talented? How can we influence the world? And we have the world's influence. So people may talk about white people or whatever, and white people are racist, but we have their kids. Their kids love our culture. I'm just jealous of the fact that we gotta kill each other and fight, but yet we control their culture. Because they pay attention to our culture. So if we smarten up and we stop killing each other and we have that business swag, and that's what I give the young people today too. They have that business acumen about them. You have more than enough examples in Jay-Z, Diddy, what Nipsey was doing. Everybody gets it now. It's just the violence. We have to live through it and live to build generational wealth.
Speaking of business, you know, is there a message that you can give to an up-and-coming artist about handling the business side of artistry, of music? Can you give them, like, not a blueprint, but some advice on what they should be looking out for, especially contracts, because a lot of kids don't know the difference in a contract, and then what they should be looking at as far as the numbers, the business side of it. Can you give some advice on that?
Well, first and foremost, the business, when you talk about business, you're talking about an investment. So you have to find money from somewhere. And I don't care who you are. Kids find $300 for Jordans, $150 for this. They love Balenciaga and the Gucci shirt. All it takes is $300 to $500 to go to an attorney and get a standard contract. Get a standard current 360 contract. You have to pay to invest in your business. So it's not like, oh, I don't have any money, so I still deserve to be in the game. No, you can't go in a car dealer and buy a car without, you know, without paying. So you have to invest in yourself. And investing in yourself is before you run out there and do something, you better pay a knowledgeable accountant and attorney to explain to you the game. And especially music attorneys. People who do this, you know what I'm saying? So they may have larger clients, so you say, oh, he represents Jay-Z, I can never afford him. That doesn't, you know, that's not necessarily the truth. An attorney may hear you or see what you're about and believe you're worth the investment and say, hey, I'm not going to charge you my full professional rate, but I believe in what you're doing and I'm going to charge you something and grow with you.
In closing, could you tell us something random about you that everyone wouldn't know? You know, we know you do the music, you're in the business, but I don't know, maybe you eat peas with sugar or something. Something random.
Jack, what did you tell her earlier? Stupid
shit.
To be honest, me, I'm a pretty private person. I do a lot of work behind the scenes, and you know, I'm just working, but I do have my girlfriend. I'm looking forward to getting married and settling down and having kids and all that stuff. All of that. I'm definitely looking forward to being more domesticated. You know what I'm saying?
So, are we invited to the wedding?
Of course you are. We gotta have that.
Free food, open bar.
I wanted to ask, what helps you stay positive throughout these years and everything that you've gone through? What helps you keep pushing forward?
It's just the pursuit of happiness. I love what I do, you know what I'm saying? So I love music, I love merchandising, I love marketing. And I love just problem solving, getting around drama. Like, we have an issue now coming up on this tour with our meet and greets, but I just love figuring out stuff. You know what I mean?
Trying to find more a solution than looking
at it. Yeah, it's never a problem. It's always a chance for a solution. So that's how I stay positive. And I know, you know, a lot of people doubt you. And people call them haters, but we used to call them sleepers. You're sleeping on me, you know what I mean? And sleeping is doubting, you know? Haters want to fucking kill you. So we come up in the 80s where you had sleepers. We had a song, Thanks for Sleepwalking. So, you know, all of our doubters who never thought we would make it, not only did we make it, we made Naughty by Nature bed sheets so they could sleep on them. Yeah.
think about that, bro. I didn't think about that, bro.
We're about to launch them again, Jack.
Oh, now.
Launch in May.
Okay. That's what's up. Hey, well, so with that being said, too, like you, bed sheets. What's something else that you have that's merchandise that we'd be surprised? Because I wasn't ready for that. Yeah. I wasn't ready for that. Do you have belts? Do you have socks?
Suspenders. A bit of everything. No sex toys yet. We have another brand, Stone by Nature, which is all about weed.
Ooh.
But I spoke with my guy, and I'm like, yo, I got these growers that ready for the strain, and we could just... And he's like, man, we just cracked Major League Baseball, y'all. I don't think it's time yet.
Yeah.
Put it in your back pocket. Yeah. But let's go get this Major League Baseball money first.
Don't hold that Conseco yourself.
And especially if you get paid in stocks, oh man, that's another combo.
See, but always have that in the back pocket. You know what I'm saying?
It ain't going nowhere.
Shoes and all that edible stuff.
Do you have?
Yeah.
Well, what happened was,
anybody ever overdose?
Right here on the show.
What you mean overdose? Oh my
God. I'm more of a smoker. I'm afraid of those edibles.
Don't be afraid.
It's a body high. You never know, like, the dosage or whatever.
It's
all
a body high.
You know it's healthier to ingest.
You have a story about what? Overdosing?
Well, I was
taking too much.
Yeah, so I was in Vegas. Shout out to Vegas. And, you know, my eyes are bigger than my stomach, or my tolerance, I should say. So I ate like more than I should have, and I literally slept all over Vegas. My friends picked me up, put me to the next spot.
Wow.
That's your Cosby shit.
Yeah.
You ain't got your Cosby shit.
I'm more of a smoker.
Don't be afraid of that edible.
But that THC is no joke.
No, it's not.
For real.
That's like that shit from Mexico we used to get in the 90s, huh?
Yeah, that's why. In that sense, I'm proud to be old school. I'm just a weed smoker.
Yeah, I can dig it. Hey, with that being said, too, now, you know, today is a lot of drug culture. You know what I'm saying? The leans and all that. Remember back in the day where the drug dealer was the cool person and the people that were using the crackhead, that shit was not cool.
Right.
This shit is in reverse. Pill popping is you the nigga if you pill popping.
Right.
You the nigga if you doing lean and all that other stuff.
And I think that's part of the problem though. Yeah. I never did any of that stuff. But I think that's part of the problem. A lot of our young brothers are not in their right fucking minds.
Mm. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? They zoned out off of all of this lean or whatever they on, and they like, you know what? And either they're down or they're up and super geeked up, and they're not in their right mind. So next thing you know, like I got a guy over in Jersey. He got so high, he went and murdered somebody.
Oh.
He didn't realize nothing he did until he woke up in that cell. Like,
you don't do that with
me. What? He's talking all the other funny, goofy, crazy shit.
That's
what I'm saying.
That's why we don't make you do that. Me make you chill up and be social.
No, right now, it don't make you do that.
That's until
right
the government
now.
That's why
you
don't
eat edible.
Listen, they about to start putting all this shit in gas stations and all. You think that's going to be pure shit that
it's
you smoke?
I'm still popping from the hood.
It's going to be. In five years,
you're going to. The government controls it.
Oh, it's on. You're going to hear about everybody dying, car accidents, and bullshit.
I think that goes hand in hand with what I've been hearing, that y'all generation or the previous generation was for, the music was for drug dealers. This generation's music is for drug users. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And I think that's the big difference.
Right. So I think with everything, you know, you got to do this stuff in moderation. because a lot of this stuff and these opioids, they're addictive. Mm-hmm. So you see these guys, they're nodding, they're dropping mad weight, they're out of control with this stuff, and you're raising a generation of junkies. Mm-hmm. So if you're not a killer, then you're a junkie. And what do you? What does that leave all of you beautiful women? Who's your baby daddy gonna be?
A junkie.
Y'all want that? Or your husband? Your husband, the father of the children.
He's gonna be a good man. I don't know what he's gonna be a good man.
He's wonderful.
I love him. That's right.
She's over there like a church lady. My man's gonna be a good man.
Clean man.
Christian man.
You ain't gonna be good.
You need that. So what do y'all think? How's the dating scene out there?
Okay.
So are there guys out there that's like, are they hit it and quit it guys? Or do you find guys who
got a pick?
Here's my thing. I think at the end of the day, however you present yourself is what you're gonna get approached with. When I post certain things and they see me as conscious or whatever, people hop in my DMs like, good evening, queen, grand rising. You know, I feel like it's all about
that bullshit.
My point being, how you present yourself is
dating scene, because a lot of people, they want to date you because they want to come up, or they think if you want to date them that you want to come up. So I think that's what's wrong with the dating scene. Social media.
Another thing that people don't know how to work things out anymore. There's like no real communication. There's always like, oh, you know what? Fuck this bitch.
Yeah.
I go on Instagram, 5-8 more or 10 more. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And women do it too. So that's a big thing. It's also a personal issue, I think, because if you don't know how to like reconcile with a person, or discern like what's good or you know what's beneficial for you, like is you just gonna move on, and that's the real issue.
Right.
Yeah. I agree with
that. And you know what, I'm gonna go with you on that. But you know, a lot of people are dating for something to do.
Yeah.
Oh, and exactly. Not because you like somebody. Yeah. Like, I just want to go out because I'm hungry tonight. You wouldn't even fuck with this person.
You know what else it could be as well, especially for men. You know, our young black men are undeceived, so with so many strikes against a lot of them, maybe you'll get in a scene where they're not willing to commit because they're not really stable with themselves.
That's true.
It's stable with their jobs, their careers, stable with what they want to do, so they're like, you know what, I'm going to be a little non-committal, and I'll just jump around. But hopefully, with more stability, you know what I mean, even on both sides of it, our people and our young people will get to a generation where there will be more marriages, there will be more commitments.
Amen.
And we have to center this thing back around the family structure, because when you break up the family structure, look at what we have. A lot of stray guys out here with no fathers, women carrying 2 and 3 kids trying to raise them by themselves. Yep. And whether it's a boy or a girl, if you can't control a guy, you're going to lose him to the streets. If you don't bring the girl up right, you're going to lose her to the strip pole or a drug dealer or the streets or whatever, because everyone's not going to be Cardi B.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? She came from the trenches. She's just one of millions.
Yeah.
who made it like that.
That
so
shit ain't gonna happen no more.
Eventually.
They trying though. They trying.
It's good for a reality show. But I think
part of the game is like there are no shortcuts in life. Yeah, I know. You know what I mean? So you can't skip over the fact that you need to be informed and educated about anything. I don't care whether you're self-taught or went to a school or went to a trade school or whatever, but if you don't know shit and you don't do shit, how can you expect to be paid shit? Mm. Ooh!
He dropped the gem just now, boy.
Oh, yeah. I was wondering how to say it. Hey, man, so, you know, when it comes to me and dating, I say this. I'm just looking for somebody on my level. I want a woman with that Michelle Obama mentality.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Somebody I ain't got to take care of, because we're going to take care of each other. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Somebody who has that same ambition and want it like I want and whatnot. And that I don't have to, we don't do the same shit, so we're able to have a real conversation.
Yes.
I hate having to go home and, you know what I'm saying, you ask somebody how their day was, but you knew how their day was because they do the same shit you do.
See, I was about to suggest, like, damn, Jack, you may need a TV producer. You're saying the exact opposite.
Well, so, I'm talking about for my real life, but I'm going to do that bullshit on Saturday. I'm talking about for real life.
So for your real life, you're in television production, and you want Michelle Obama, yeah. So what, a nerdy lawyer?
I take that.
Yeah.
She can hold on. She just made $10 million off her memoir.
This year. You better watch.
I'm sorry, sold 10 million copies.
You better watch it. It's a lot of little horny lawyers out there, too.
Where you at? Bring your short ass on over here. Clap Huxtable, where you at, baby? Where you at, Clap? I'm looking for you. Come on now. What a girl I'm living single with, Maxine Shaw? Where Maxine Shaw at? What's happening? I like her. Hey, y'all got anything else for Vinny before we close on that?
No.
Shit. Vinny, you got anything else for us?
Yes.
Before we close on that?
Yes. This is Vin Rock from the legendary Naughty by Nature, giving a big shout out to Party and Bullshit Show, the Angels right here, you know, Jack's Angels. And thanks for having me. Thanks for always supporting me. Check us out on naughtybynature.com. All of our social media is there. Check us out on the New Kids Tour featuring New Kids on the Block, Salt and Pepper, Tiffany, Debbie Gibson, 57 Arena, starting May 2nd through July 14th. Look us up, baby.
Yeah.